So we will sort of follow the content of why this briefing, local authority considerations, transformation in Wokingham, context for waste authorities, and finance. We find this an hour's worth of your time well invested. So waste authorities going through, and preparing for significant change. Lots of work that's been undertaken with the professional bodies, with the LGA, Local Government Association, with Adept in preparing for all of this, whether it's simple recycling, whether it's ETS emissions trading schemes. And we're doing all of that within a sort of a background of ever continuing financial pressures on a local authority. So whether that's revenue, and any sort of concerns about sort of, potential section 114s and protecting that budget. All of this is done in the context of ever increasing greater demand for local authority services, homelessness, SENS, adults and children's, social care, all putting that pressure into the service. Waste and recycling services then coming along and dealing with the sort of the drivers and the pressures that might need to be done. So whether that's fuel, whether that's inflation, whether that's sort of contract pricing, whether that's adhering to new legislation, whether that's thinking about decarbonisation, whether that's thinking of recycling rates and all that goes with that. So there is a lot to do, there's a lot to consider, there's a lot for local authorities to work through. Your sort of section 151 officers in pulling together that sort of borough, district or unitary budget, and that cycle will be starting relatively soon. All of those considerations need to be coming through, and also with EPR and sort of payments, shortly to sort of be released, and then any sort of approvals or challenges to that, and for those to be finalised. There'll be a lot of sort of turbulence within the waste and recycling arena, and a lot there to be considered. So within that pivotal time, and for us as leaders, some of the bigger things for local authorities are the economy. So the economy is all and growing that transport, cost of living, and really how we support our communities as a placemaker. What do we do as part of that civic landscape? What do we do in our sort of communities and neighbourhoods? How do we improve that, and how do we contribute to all of that? We are a regulator, we regulate things. We bring in environmental legislation, we set out requirements for waste and recycling, and we bring all of those elements together. And it's also a part that in the future we'll be playing in that. We will be an enabler. Most local authorities have a corporate KPI of driving recycling rates and also reducing tonnage to landfill, reducing tonnage to landfill, and also in decarbonisation as well, and making sure that those elements are well weaved in to any sort of budgetary services or pressures is obviously a key. We're also an advocate as well. Where we bring forward new schemes, what does that mean? As we weave into the sort of the public health agenda as well, the overall quality of life. And we're a key barometer issue, as everybody would know, for a local authority as well. So don't talk to me about, economic growth strategies. Don't talk to me about prosperity boards, and don't talk to me about major transformation improvements in the local authorities when you can't collect the waste, you can't collect the recycling, you can't deal with fly tips, and you can't sort of clean the streets properly. So key area for those services to buy sort of credibility, and also to obtain space for those discussions to be enabled. And obviously we're a provider of public services, we provide the services that most people expect a council to do, and we're all acutely attuned to that. So in preparing for changes, what are some considerations that I often sort of brief staff and brief local authorities in order to do? And that's really sort of, you know, the priorities of understanding the rhythm of the council and its partners. What is the council trying to achieve? What's its corporate plan? Where does it want to land? What's its sort of messages and narratives that it's giving out to its communities? What does it want to say in 2 and 3 years? So that sort of, you know, percolates down into the culture of the organisation. You know, what space, what room for manoeuvre, what discussions are going on? Key within all of this is the political requirements and the political cycle. Where are the elections? Where are the by-elections? Is that next year? Is it 2 years away? What sort of appetite is there for moving forward and advancing the services or changing the services? And how does that fit into that sort of key election cycle? And that should be a key consideration. And everybody should be mindful of that. Obviously, corporate plans and alignment to key partners and stakeholders. So what's in the corporate plan? What's under the environmental issues within that plan? What's under the decarbonisation? Where are we on recycling? What does the council want to say? Those would be key issues and considerations in thinking through any sort of advance movement on this. And also being really sort of mindful as a service leader as well about what the ambition of the council is against its capabilities. So what, you know, is the capability of the service? What's the capability of the support services, as in legal, finance, performance, scrutiny, all of those? Most local authorities and most sort of major services, such as waste, such as highways, always seem to sort of have a struggle and always seem to have an issue when there's a disparity between ambition and the capability. And it's really key that you keep that you're really sort of honest with that, and how quick can the service and the organisation move to accommodate any changes. And what is the stakeholder view, and what's the added value of all of this? So if you've got town councils, if you've got parish councils, if you've got district councils or boroughs that sit within your sort of local authority and public sector structure, what are their views and what's there? And it's about making sure that engagement is really sort of clear and those metrics are really well discussed through. So I always sort of class these as lagging versus lagging indicators. So what are our challenges? All of those issues above that have just gone through on that schematic. What are the metrics? What are we measuring? And are those defined and are clearly communicated? And does everybody understand, you know, what sort of success or what good looks like, and how we move that forward? What sort of challenges or tensions are there in a fixed mind or the growth mind? Are you able to advance the debate? Are you able to show with evidence where, you know, the preparations, any sort of legal requirements could go? Or are there sort of fixed views there? And what's your approach to that? And again, that sort of manoeuvrability space. So where are you within the finances of the local authority, and what manoeuvrability have you got there? What contractual space have you got? Are you just going through a new sort of procurement? Are you sort of within a current procurement? Or have you got an in-house service? And what manoeuvrability have you got within that? And what are your contract terms and conditions? And making sure that those are well sort of understood and specced out. And also looking at political cover as well. You know, what's the view of your portfolio holder, your committee, your informal cabinet, your scrutiny committees? And what's their view on this, and what's their appetite? And how much risk, in inverted commas, are they prepared to take, or perhaps not on that? And all of these issues will start to sort of flush out perhaps a clearer flight path in moving forward. And again, considering those sort of views as well, what's the view of the chief executive, leaders of the council, your scrutiny, your prosperity boards, and your community narrative? So going back to, where is the service now and where do you want it to be positioned in the future? And again, in my experience, most members, most committees, you know, experience stories better than sort of facts and figures. So what's the story that you'd like to take forward? And how would you like to portray that? What are your intelligence networks? What is your customer services or your front door to the organisation? What is that telling you? And where is that coming? And where do you sit with your neighbours, your neighbour local authorities and their services? And what's their preparation with that? And perhaps those are some considerations that you would need to think through. So within Wokingham, we've just gone through a major service transformation. We brought that in on the 12th of August this year, and we're still going through that. We set out some clearer objectives for that. So reduction in refuse tonnages, carbon savings of 2,400 tonnes of CO2, increase the recycling rate to 64%, and generate £1 million worth of revenue savings. This was moving a weekly collection service into a fortnightly collection service. And within all of that, all of those slides that I've gone through previously came into play, talking to members, talking to scrutiny, talking to the chief exec, talking to the leader of the council, talking to neighbouring authorities, seeing what sort of bandwidth we've got within our existing sort of contracts with our partners, which were Veolia on this, making sure that we've got daily meetings and updates with customer services teams. So we're receiving all the information and data that we came in. So just to update on that, our sort of recycling rate is now about 63%. It still needs to settle down. We sort of wax and wane between about 61.5% and 63%, but the trajectory is that it will hit 64% the later that we go into the year. Sort of savings within our medium term financial plan are on track for those to be achieved, and our sort of waste tonnage has reduced significantly. So all of that again aligns with our environmental strategies, our decarbonisation plans, and all of those elements coming in. So the overall sort of delivery of the service was not about can we just run a cheaper service, as that sort of slide tries to outline. We set four really clear success criteria. We set out really clear project outcomes that we'd like to achieve. We talked those through with scrutiny. We made sure that the metrics were clearly understood, and then we put all of those governance things in place to make sure that they went through really well. The press and the communication strategy that we wrapped around that was really key, and we had an approved communication strategy that started working months before the changes. Members were briefed, communities were briefed. We took on engagement officers, and they went out into communities and into local social networks and made sure that those messages were put across. So Steve Brown, as the service director, would say this, wouldn't he? But the overall sort of view back from the communities and back from the council was the transition to make those improvements went about as smooth as it could be, and we had no real major issues. And this was an actual slide that we presented to scrutiny earlier in the year, given some of the outcomes of where we landed on the social media and on our communication strategy. And again, going back to issues such as telling the story, keeping a constant narrative, rolling that out with the bin deliveries and the properties that we've visited and the social media it's that we achieved and managed to obtain. So there's sort of just to a degree has settled on, you know, on the general election, and we're all getting to grips with what do we need to do and what should we be preparing, and simpler recycling and ETS and EPR and all of that going through. And we're aware that DEFRA have announced sort of its five priorities, what, you know, one of which is to create the roadmap to a zero waste economy, that linking in again with carbon and environmental declarations that most local authorities have bought in. And again, mentions from DEFRA as well about that sort of circular economy and how we contributing to all of that. Still again, the professional bodies, the LGA, ADEPT, other organisations like that are still providing information, and there's still the monthly call that most people I would guess on this seminar attend with DEFRA as well, where we're still sort of getting those updates and those clarifications, and certainly some of those preparation issues coming through. The next few slides will then start to pick up on what are those future considerations that should be thought of. So context really for waste authorities are the environmental declarations and climate emergencies. A lot of that, you know, that agenda will hang into this, that circular economy will fit into this, that decarbonisation, that showing that sort of improvement, and certainly on the sort of waste transformation at Wokingham, we'll spend as much time talking about decarbonisation, we'll be responding to the climate agenda and the scrutiny on that, then we probably would be on waste. So it's really important that all the key officers in that service have got a real good understanding of that narrative and those sort of intersection points between all of that. Certainly for us, looking at population growth as well is a key issue. By and large in Wokingham, there's about 1,000 new houses a year coming on stream. And we've sort of mapped that out for the next 10 to 15 year period, so we can, you know, forecast within our contract cycle where the new houses will be, what part of the borough that will be, and what does that mean for our sort of waste tonnages and our recycling and our collection and our contract requirements. The economic climate as well, and also considering what that will mean, you know, for cost of living and any issues that could come through the local authority and how that may impact or not on the service. We also spent a fair bit of time in preparing for all of this on local authority demographics. So it was our population, where are we, where are they, how are they contributing to this? And knowing that on some of our recycling rounds, you know, we get 2 to 3% more recycling on some rounds than others, and what's the difference there, and what could be the drivers, and what do we need to do to look at that? So again, using that real sort of data-driven approach to make sure that we understand all of that data and analysis, and we've got a plan to constantly improve and challenge that. Key was the communication strategy. So we brought in the transformation of the service on August 12th. On March the 31st, which was the end of the financial year, we were coming in at about 52% recycling rate. On mid-April, we got that up to about sort of 55, 56. And the only sort of variable for us was that we hadn't changed the service. We hadn't brought in any of the changes at that point, but the communication strategy was in its sort of full pomp at that stage. So we were out on social media, the council's website was updated. We were emailing all residents through the borough council's updates and social media platforms. And all of that information did seem to increase our recycling by about sort of 2% just because of clear communications and preparing people for the changes that would have come in a few months later. We made sure as well that sort of members, so via informal cabinet, via cabinet, via scrutiny, via political party briefings and updating on all the key messages and the risks and the pressures and the drivers and the potential success criteria that we had that all for this, that members understood exactly where we were, members understood exactly where some of the issues were, members understood that, you know, that the data was starting to sort of trickle in, that we were on the right path and that things were improving. So again, when bringing in new sort of waste and recycling legislation or changes or regulations, making sure that you're out in front, making sure that you're briefing your members and your key decision makers sort of early and well, and taking them through the issues and where the service is positioned, you know, is absolutely crucial, because there's one thing in delivering it and there's another thing in making sure that you retain the members' confidence. A bit like a restructure that you would have in a service for your staffing levels, any sort of transformation or change, there's always going to be a bit of a dip in performance. There's always going to be an increase in complaints. And it's just making sure that narrative is in place so everybody understands that and everybody's got confidence that the path is there and exactly what the flight plan is. And then everybody then can adhere to that. And then the benefits then will seem to come through. We talked about the government requirements for simpler recycling, an EPR and ETS, and we're all sort of looking at those and we're all getting information on that and we're all looking at the latest updates and making sure that we're being prepared for that as well. To a degree, using things like the Local Authority Data Explorer, albeit that information is a few years old, but certainly in the future, you know, that information will be used and people will be looking at that, and undoubtedly members will be referring to that in the future to see where the service is positioned. And again, going back to that issue of service capacity. So what is the capacity to deliver and bring in these new changes? And what is the planning element required about that? And one of the key issues is the bandwidth of the service. So there's business as usual, and running a waste and recycling service in the local authority takes a lot of care, takes a lot of attention, takes a lot of, you know, operational and strategic management time. Bringing in changes driving those through your authority, through your finance system, through your governance system, through your performance system, through your contract management system, takes a lot of time and effort, and it's making sure that you've got people assigned to that. It's making sure that you've got a team on that. It's making sure that you've got really good governance and a really effective plan wrapped around that, and you're able to sort of coordinate that with providing sort of confidence to members that all is in place and you know, this will go through. And it's not to underestimate the political capital that the members or your leading administration will put into this. So it's ensuring that they've got confidence as well of that. You know, they will be taking that sort of political risk as well, and it's making sure that they're sort of really well briefed as, you know, one of your most important stakeholders. And also going back to that previous point at the beginning of the presentation, which is being really mindful of the election cycle and those considerations, which will be at the foremost of members' mind, especially if you're in a local authority where power can change or there's a few seats in it and it could go into a sort of minority administration or no overall control. So again, you know, it's about, you know, being in control of the change, leading the change, making sure that the wider organisation and your stakeholders are aware of what's being done, and not sort of getting into the position of, you know, it's being done to you, you know, you're following events and being dictated by events. It's about being key on that and making sure that you're sort of lead that. So reviewing your plans, making sure that your plans are in place and engaging all of those data sources that you should be, your comms team, customer services team, any of your sort of democratic services colleagues that would know what sort of questions members are raising, and making sure that you're well plugged into your portfolio holder on that issue. So again, bringing in sort of changes and preparing for waste and recycling, a lot of political conditioning. So that issue of the leadership of the council, briefed, issues raised, a line of sight is created. They know exactly where you're going. They know exactly what the outcomes will be. They know exactly what the milestones will be. You know, and all of that is agreed in advance. So there's no surprises coming through. And, you know, a technique that's often really sort of, served well for me is you almost do an event calendar. So 6 weeks blocks of events. So in this 6 weeks, this is what will be happening. Next 6 weeks, 6 week block after that. So members and the leading administration can see when press releases will be going out, when decisions will be coming, when scrutiny papers are being raised, when questions at council will be being asked, so they can see all of that and they appreciate and can understand that there's a plan there underpinning that and it's being worked on and events are being led rather than being dictated to. There's obviously the question of finance, revenue and capital budgets. And again, obvious considerations there to be considered. And at Wokingham, these were exactly the considerations that we went through. So what changes are coming in? And what does that mean for the council and for existing contracts and agreements? So we went through at the beginning of the presentation about you know, the political side and the budgetary and the issues to do with local authorities and the sort of downward pressure on revenue for local authorities and the wider pressures that that's dealing with, and what are these issues and the funding issues that will come through, and what does that mean for existing sort of contracts and arrangements with delivery partners, whether you're in an in-house service, whether it's contracted out to a third-party operator, or whether you're just sort of collecting the waste and you take that part to a wider waste disposal authority. So have all of those things been flagged and been talked through? What are the issues? What are the stumbling blocks coming through within that? Again, picking up capital and revenue planning, contract requirements, making sure that those are well sort of flushed out. What are your commercial amendments that you might need to take? And what relationships have you got with your commercial partners? You know, will that be sort of collaborative? Will that be a slightly different view? And what are the issues in that? And again, working that through and planning that through. Really key and overpinning all of this is obviously project management and having that sort of key project that looks after all of this and brings all of those strands together, your customer service, your governance, your IT, your commercial issues, your contract and review, your capital and your revenue, and making sure that those sort of key milestones are done. And within that project management, you know, running a board that has senior leaders on it, senior finance people, senior IT, senior performance colleagues on that. So discussions are held at that level. They can see the plan. They can see the milestones being achieved and are aware to some of the discussions and the pressures that are being worked through. And again, it's providing for me that sense of confidence as well. What does this mean for sort of IT? Does that need to be changed? And in my experience, you can never give too long a leading period to IT colleagues. So making sure that that's well thought through, what needs to be done, and working at all of that and engaging IT colleagues in all of that as part of your overall project management is really key. A really obvious issue is looking at your fleet review. You know, have you got enough fleet? Have you got enough combination of fleet? Have you got enough capacity within that? If you're bringing in sort of glass collections or increasing your recycling, what is the plan for that? Is that process mapped out? Have you got that really fully costed? Are you going to sort of implement it, you know, in its entirety, or are you going to incrementally bring that in? And again, as part of that project management, end-to-end process mapping or end-to-end flow charting is really key. So making sure that you flush all of those issues out, you bring in all your partners and your stakeholders to make sure that that process mapping, you know, is well worked through, you know, even getting independent and doing a sort of mini peer review of getting external sort of people to come in and have a look at that and check and challenge that, and quite often feeding that back through your governance or your scrutiny, you know, is a worthwhile thing. So in Wokingham, when we put forward our project metrics, we asked the internal audit at that stage to review it and challenge our sort of metrics and our sort of processes and systems for implementing waste changes, transformation. And that was really, really powerful when we were updating at scrutiny and when we were feeding that back to individual political parties, that we'd almost got a third party assurance that internal audit had looked at this, you know, had produced a report on this and then I'd identified no concerns at all. Yes, they came forward with some suggestions and we incorporated them, but that sort of independent person, you know, giving that external reassurance is a real real contributing support to any changes. And again, that sort of considering your plants and your recycling centres and whatever your arrangements are, what are your capacities? Has that been thought through? Are your plants able to deal with any sort of increases in that recycling? What would be the costs of that? Are the leading periods? All of those would be really crucial. Now, I'm sure that colleagues on the, you know, on the meeting today are already having those discussions, but that was really clear for us. And again, you could never provide a leading time that was too long on that. In my experience, local authorities' business planning processes probably takes a year to get through. So business case, going through CLT, your corporate leadership team, taking that to scrutiny, getting that through your medium term sort of financial plan, getting that into budgets the following year. So again, that sort of governance, that project management, and making sure that you're allowing plenty of time for your local authority business process to move forward and go and achieve your intended outcomes. Obvious issue, receptacles, so recycling boxes, bags, small plastic bins, new waste bins, whatever that might need to be done. again, lead in times for that, you know, that could be some significant cost, you know, $500,000, $750,000, £1 million for local authorities if you needed to do that. And again, making sure that that's all thought of and considered as part of this as well. And again, looking at that issue of lead in times. So again, that really key project plan, that really clear governance, that really clear sort of board approach in making sure that these things are thought through. And again, feeding back to the council about finance, driving performance. So what does the service need? What are the legal requirements that need to be brought through? Are you demonstrating value for money and really effective use of council budgets and any sort of growth funding that you need to do, and bringing forward those sort of outcomes and metrics as well. So it's really important, again, that confidence point, that soft skill in making sure that confidence is maintained, people are well communicated with, and those messages are clear and going out. And again, picking up on that point as well, financial control, management, governance, to ensure that you're all prepared. And again, not to understand the bandwidth requirements of running the service on a day-to-day requirement, but thinking about these changes, thinking about the governance, thinking about the briefings, thinking about your fleet reviews, thinking about your financial cycles, thinking about your performance, and thinking about those future issues would be a really, really clear thing. So lots of time for that, and making sure that you're bringing in our project managers, transformation specialists, people that can provide that project management governance to give you that sort of control and ability to extrapolate that key information and pass on really clear and accurate information and data within the council and to stakeholders as required.